Hey, Jay Shrek, guess where we're at today? We are at the Superstition Mountains, and it's the first day of May, and the mountains are absolutely gorgeous today. I'll give you a little shot about what we got. It's extremely green. It's getting ready to turn on us, so it won't be long that it will be getting to be a little more brown. But today what we're going to do is we're going to go up the world-famous Peralta Trail, which is probably one of the best-known trails in the Superstition Mountains. It is considered to be the best hike in the state of Arizona. It's an easy trip in. It's a pretty long gravel road. Now, a lot of people, you might get confused. When you come off the 60, you'll be in a neighborhood and you'll think, there's no way in hell that I can be out here in the Superstitions where the Lost Dutchman traveled. But you're only in that neighborhood for a quick, brief period of time, and then you're out, and you get out pretty rural, pretty quick. But this is it's beautiful today. It's gorgeous. The weather is perfect. It's starting to turn just a little bit, but this is where the famous Peralta family massacre happened, thus the Peralta Trail. Now, the Peralta family was a world-class miners out of Sonoran, Mexico, and they had come up here one last time to be able to try to get gold out of the Superstitions before the land was turned back over to the United States. And so they made one more attempt to come in and pull all the gold out of the Superstitions that they could have. Now, at that point also, the amount of trails that were out here with the Indians, this was a brutal place. It was a violent place. There were deaths and massacres and murders and scalpings and all the things that make up a great story, but the only thing about this story is it was true. So we're going to go hike the Peralta Trail. So you've decided to be a Dutch hunter, right? Well, this would be a good place just to come out and get your feet wet. And we're going to talk a lot about, you know, how I prepare to go out, how you prepare to start your search, your journey on what you want to do and how you want to do it. The Superstition Mountains is 166,000 acres. So we're going to look at just a small thumbnail of what this is all about. But this is a gorgeous place. It's beautiful, and we're going to go to the Peralta Trailhead. We're going to go by the Peralta Massacre Grounds, where supposedly the mule train was attacked by Indians, and as they chased them out and stole the gold. Well, I just signed into the trailhead. This is the trailhead for the Peralta, the Lost Gold Trailhead, right here. Here's the sign right there. Kind of hard to read. Here's kind of what you're looking at right here. How awesome is that? I tell you what, this is just a gorgeous place if you get to come out here just to hike the trail, let alone if you're looking for gold. We're going to talk about what it takes to be a treasure hunter in the Superstition Wilderness. It's not for your average guy, so make sure that you follow the regulations, the rules and regulations of the Superstition Mountains. Take a look at this. Tell you what, we've been hiking just, 20-25 minutes, not a lot. And as you can see, you know, when you're in a canyon and there's no wind, you know, a super easy hike, I'm not going to say it becomes hard, but it definitely becomes moderate. So, you know, getting a little higher elevation, even though I had to work for it, definitely feels a lot better with this cool breeze. So, I guess my point is this. Well, you think it's going to be a super easy hike, all of a sudden you're in the heat, and you know it's supposed to be around 100 today, and in Phoenix standard that's 80 in the Midwest, 85 max, so it's pretty mild. But people say it's a dry heat, you know,
hell's a dry heat too, so don't let them fool you. Even somebody that hikes a lot can definitely feel when you start gaining altitude, and also you get sun, direct sun with no breeze. Now there's some places on the trail that are shaded, so you definitely have places to stop and rest, which you're going to be able to see because I'm time-lapsing this whole hike, so you can get a real good idea of what this is about. Well, I'm starting up the draw. You can kind of see where I came from down below in that valley. And I'm going to look around real quick, show you what's here. Now, right up in there is called Geronimo's Cave. And I think the myth is bigger than the truth, but it was told that Geronimo threw dynamite out of that cave down below on the Calvary down below. Haven't been able to verify that. Haven't been able to verify that that was Geronimo's cave, but it's a damn good story, isn't it? I think it's awesome. Let's go on up this draw. And bam! You're at the top. So, you know, if you want to take the easy way up, that was definitely the easy way. Now, right in our distance is probably the most famous landmark in all the Superstition Mountains. And so if you've never been here and this is your first opportunity to get to be a Dutch hunter, that's going to be your best landmark right there. Even though there's places you can't see it, that is Weaver's Needles. And that was named after Pauline Weaver, which was basically the first white settler in these areas. And so that's why they call it Weaver's Needle. Now, some of the earlier pioneers called it the Finger of God. And the Indians called it Mare's Dick. So there's kind of a difference between Mare's Dick and the Finger of God. But either way, that is probably one of the greatest shots in the entire Superstition Mountains on my in my belief right there, right? And so a lot of people believed that the gold was hidden in that, right? So if you go up to the mound or the base of that, there's still cables, things like that, because they climbed that. And some of them didn't climb it too well. Some of them fell. So a lot of people died in this area. I mean, people died all over. This is probably one of the most fascinating places that I've ever been. I mean, I love it. If you'll notice that hike was absolutely fabulous. It took me 43 plus about an hour and 20 minutes to get up here is what it comes down to. I got up here at 11:27 and I left at 10:17, so you do the math. But not a bad hike. That was not killer, but to tell you that it didn't hit me at all, that would be lying too. So, you know, let's talk about the Superstition Mountains. And let's talk about the fact that what it's going to take. So let's find a nice rock here with an unbelievable maybe sight of the Dutchman behind me. And so what's things that you need to know before you come here? Man, you got to get in some type of shape, even if you don't have maybe a place around you to hike maybe as much as you'd like to, but you can always go to the mall. And I probably sound stupid, but if you're in some place where it snows all the time, I mean, just get laps and get time in, get time in hiking out here, because I tell you what, it's a tough deal. So the first thing you're thinking about when you're out here in the Lost Dutchman is Superstition Mountains is the number one thing you got to have on your plate, right? Number one is survival. You got to be ready to survive out here over everything. So first thing I do is I'm prepared, right? I've gotten shape. I'm able to go hike. Because one thing you're going to find out is if you just came up here to hike, it was a great hike. But now I'm up here, I'm going to set up some type of base camp. I'm going to make sure that I have water or find water, because if I don't find water up here, I'm not going to be up here very long. And I'm also looking at things that, you know, God forbid something comes goes wrong, where I can find shelter, where I can find something to eat, whether it be, you know, a barrel cactus or whatever that might be, prickly pear. What is available to me just to survive? Because that's key number one. If you don't survive up here, guess what? It doesn't really matter. You're not going to find anything. And the only thing you're going to lose is maybe your life. So the first thing I do is I get prepared. I'm prepared to come up here because look at that vast valley down there. And we ain't even got started. And you see those peaks over here? We haven't even got started. All this, as far as the eye can see, is the Superstition Mountains almost. Now, there's a little over here, it's not. But back in here, his entire... And if you'll notice, just coming up that draw, how many places that you really couldn't even see. So it's a very, very difficult thing to hike. And it's a hell of a lot more difficult even to then go explore to try to find the whole reason that you came up here to begin with. And that was to find the Lost Dutchman's Gold. So let's talk a little bit about what I do. First thing is, anytime I come into Superstition, if there is a book, I sign it. And you know, they're not after you up here. They're not, you know, they're not after you to try to find out if you're up here looking for the lost. They don't care. What's the difference between lost and looking for the Lost Dutchman's Gold and hiking? There's none, right? They don't care. Let people know where you're at first off before you even start hiking. Let somebody know when you're planning on coming back, right? That's critical here, that you're smart about how you do it. You know, you prepped yourself. You've got yourself in pretty good shape. You're ready to come up here. You're ready to experience what it's like to be a Dutchman and to find that lost gold. And so you're prepared. You physically got ready to go. Now you've got to make sure that you have all the proper gear. That is a whole nother segment in itself. And then how long are you going to be up here? So if you're going to be up here a while, and depending on where you're at up here, if you don't have water up here, you're going to die. That's just the way it is. You're not going to be able to even, just let alone surviving, but not even surviving, you're not going to be able to make it. So there's so much that you need to do, and you need to be smart about it. First thing I always do before I go is I make sure my phone's charged. There are areas out here that you can't get reception, but you know, if you're walking out of here, you might find a place you can. Now, what happens if you would happen to need help? Well, I'm going to tell you, your trip out of here is going to be probably your most expensive. Probably $20,000 to $40,000 is what it's going to cost you to get airlifted out of here. So be prepared to pay a big bill. So that's another reason that you don't want to get yourself in a scenario or a situation where you have to get airlifted out of here. Not that it couldn't happen, and yeah, $20,000 or $40,000 is not very much money if it meant you were going to die. But up to that point, you know, make sure that you're prepared. So I'm looking at everything around me, right? I'm looking at all that. What could I eat? What could I use? What's available to me? Where is there a cave? Where is there a crevice? Where is there places to go? What happened? You might come up here and get into weather. You know, when you're up on peaks out here, especially, lightning in the desert is brutal. And you don't want to be up on these mountaintops when the lightning hits in the desert. Because if you ever saw pictures of it, and this is where the lightning goes all the way across the sky, right? It's absolutely unbelievable what it does. And you don't want to be around it either. So there's so many things that you have to be prepared for when you come up here that a lot of people don't realize is that, as beautiful as it is, you got to be prepared.